Praise the Lord. Thank you for joining Evangelist King on this live broadcast. Faith in God comes as we hear the Word of God. Holy Ghost Fire Talk on Mondays and Fridays at 12 noon and Shalom Morning Prayer on Tuesdays at 8 o'clock a.m. Instant Time. Listen to the Holy Ghost talk to you. Here's your host, Evangelist King. Hallelujah.
I worship you.
Praise the living God, dear hearts. Thank you for joining me again on Holy Ghost Fire Talk. This is Evangelist King. I want to thank all of you who joined me for this live broadcast. Praise the living God. Thank you for your encouragement today, because when you join the live broadcast, you encourage me greatly. And also thank you for your prayers in Jesus' mighty name. Now today, dear heart, we're going to start a brand new teaching series entitled, How to Keep the Devil Out of Your Life. Now these teaching series, and I'm going to bring probably in the next, it might be a few years, because Rick Renner have a lot of teaching material. I'm using his material to teach, allow the Holy Ghost to use me to teach you and teach I as well. You know, I praise and thank God for men and women of God who God have inspired in his word to teach us. You know, it really helps us with our walk in Christ Jesus, you know, and it's a blessing that they share. You know, God blesses me with revelation, I share. God blesses you with revelation, you share. Praise the living God. So if you ever want to, you know, get the teaching material on your own, just go to Rick Renner Ministries, which is Renner, R-E-N-N-E-R .org. And you can feel free to order his materials and right there at your own home and in your secret place where you be alone with the Lord and just meditate and study on his word. Praise the living God. So the first lesson that we're going to talk about today in how to keep the devil out of your life is entitled, What Does It Mean to Be Sober and Vigilant? You know, the scripture is coming from 1 Peter 5th chapter, verse 8. It says, be sober, be vigilant, because your adversary, the devil, as a roaring lion, walketh about, seeking whom he may devour. See, the word of God tells us that we have an adversary, we have an enemy. And that's because God has an enemy. And whenever we receive the Lord, dear heart, and come on his side, then that means we are the devil's enemy. And he's our adversary. As a warring lion, he walks about seeking whom he may devour. 1 Thessalonians, the 5th chapter, verses 6 and 8 say, therefore, let us not flee, as do others. But let us watch and be sober. But let us who are of the day be sober, putting on the breastplate of faith during the day, every day, putting on the breastplate of faith, keeping it on, in love, for in helmet, the hope of salvation. Our hope is always in the Lord. That's why our hope is not in any other thing, dear heart. Our hope in the Lord. You know, your job, that you so desire and love, the house, the spouse, the children, or the car, or whatever, that is not your hope. That is not my hope. Because those things are temporal. If we put our hope in those things, dear heart, when they die, we die along with them. But our hope is always in the Lord, the hope of our salvation, spending eternity with our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Our hope is in him. 2 Timothy 4th chapter, verse 5 say, but watch thou in all things. Be watchful in all things. Endure afflictions. We're going to have afflictions, but we must endure them. Do the work of an evangelist. What should an evangelist do? Proclaim the good news of Jesus Christ. Make full proof of thy ministry. Praise the living God. 1 Peter 1st chapter, verse 13, wherefore, gird up the loins of your mind. Be sober. And hope to the end for the grace that is to be brought unto you at the revelation of Jesus Christ. 1 Peter 4 chapter verse 7. But the end of all things is at hand. But ye therefore sober and watch unto prayer. So these scriptures here is warning you and I to always to be sober. Now let's look at the definition for the word sober. The Greek definition. As you know, I cannot pronounce these Greek words, so it's good that you get the teaching study guide for yourself and see what that Greek word is and look it up and learn how to pronounce it, you know, and it'll help you greatly. So right now, you know, I'm not going to pronounce it. I'm just going to give you the meaning of the Greek word. So the one of the Greek word for the word devour, remember in 1 Peter 5 chapter verse 8, it tells us that the devil walketh about seeking whom he may devour. So the Greek meaning devour means to drink or swallow down, to devour, to destroy. Now keep that in mind. Now we know devour means to destroy. I don't think we knew it also means to drink or to swallow down. Also, the Greek definition for the word sober, which means to be sober, not drunk, and we know that. Also means to be free from delirium, delusions, and hallucinations that may accompany drunkenness. It means think straight, not like a silly drunk. A drunken person thinks silly. It means to be free of silly thinking and able to have presence of mind and clear judgment. Enable one to be in control of their thinking rather than be controlled by urges, impulses, whims, and fluctuation emotions. It's to have one's wits about themselves. It's to be rational, the opposite of irrational. It means to be free from a drunken state in which one drops their guard and is more likely to give way to foolish behavior. Unreasonable conversation and detrimental decision. It means to be serious-minded. Let me talk to a person. Truth, because why you got to be so serious? That's because you're sober-minded. So don't get offended at that anymore. You just smile and say, thank you. Because they just told you you were sober-minded. So to be sober, to be serious-minded. Now, there's an example that's given here. Because here in this country, we don't have, you know, fortresses that were built. But in Moscow, in Russia, they did. So in the 15th century, fortification walls were constructed in Moscow to protect its residents by keeping evil forces on the outside. Now, these walls were built because the city and all of Russia had been attacked by many times by Genghis Khan and his grandson, by Sweden, by the Teutonic Order, by Napoleon in the year 1812, and then during World War I and World War II. However, Moscow walls were so secure that parts of the city were never penetrated by any foreign aggressor. Now, these walls were designed to keep the enemy on the outside, and that's exactly what they did. Now, there is an enemy they were trying to penetrate our life, but we can build a strong barricade to keep those evil forces on the outside. See, demons are not supposed to be on the inside of God's children. They're supposed to be on the outside. Now, this 10-part series will give us practical steps to keep the devil out of our house, out of our health, out of our family finances, and out of our life. Now, the reason or the emphasis for this lesson is for us to be sober-minded in the last day so that we will be kept from being devoured by the enemy. That's the purpose of this lesson. Being sober-minded in the last day will keep us from being devoured by the enemy. In 1 Peter 5th chapter, verse 8, Peter describes the activity of the devil as he tries to get into our lives. At the time this verse was written, the apostle Peter was a very elderly man, full of wisdom and revelation of God. He was right to impart very common sense advice, to the people of God about how to live. Peter said, be sober, be vigilant, because your adversary, the devil, because a lot of people think the devil is just God's adversary, but the devil is also our adversary because of who we belong to. As a roaring lion, he walketh about seeking whom he may devour. Peter, as an elderly man, one Christian believer. Because they have a tendency to forget. They have a tendency to forget that there is an enemy that is after our soul. And that's why Peter wanted to be sober, to be vigilant. Now, when we see the word devour in this verse, we probably visualize a lion devouring the meat of an animal that he has already killed. But the Greek word for devour is actually from the root word, and I can pronounce this word pino, P-I-N-O, which really doesn't mean to devour at all. It literally means, or actually means, to drink. To drink. So this verse is a picture of a lion hovering over the carcass of a dead beast. But the meat is already gone. All that's left is the bone and the fluid of the animal. And the lion is hungrily slurping up those juices. Peter used this word to tell us what the devil wants to do to you and do to me. He wants to mess us up. He wants to maul us, victimize us, and he wants to take us now, not just to chew and devour us, dear heart, but to so totally consume us that there's nothing left but our juices so he can slurp up what remains. Ain't that disgusting, dear heart? That's the type of person the devil is. Walketh about seeking whom he may devour. Seeking whom, not just to destroy, but he want to eat up your meat and then strip up the juices. And you seen an animal do that? I watch Animal Kingdom all the time and see those lions eating those wildebeest and other animals. And they be just chewing on the bone and sipping up the juices. Well, that's the devourer. That's the devil. It's what the devil wants to do to us. Have you seen movies like that where they have people killing people, hacking them up, and even eating their meat and sipping up their juices? That's what the devil wants to do to us. And a lot of you go to those movies, you enjoy it. If you enjoy such movies like that, that means the devourer is in you. That devourer, the devil's in you, the one who is enjoying such horror movie. No. I mean, you literally enjoy. There's a difference in watching something and then you enjoying it as you're watching it. No, it should be disgusting, so disgusting that you got to say, I can't stand this. You turn that thing off. But that's the way the devil wants to do it. That's why we should give thanks to God in everything, because God protects us from unseen danger. If God opens our spiritual eyes, we actually see those demons trying to get us. I remember a little girl, I heard those demons trying to get me. Little girl stayed with my uncle because his girlfriend, sister, stayed with her overnight. We were around the same age, so she wanted me to sleep over with her, and I said, yes. Well, unknown to me, my uncle was into witchcraft. So those spirits was in his house. So we went to bed that night, and I woke up to some hideous sound of creatures. I mean, sound so terrible, trying to get where we are. And they couldn't come through the door. And I was a little girl. Now, that was the Lord, as a little girl, opened my ears up to the spiritual realm to warn me, let me hear what actually was around and in my uncle's house, so I never stay there again. And I knew those creatures was after me and this my friend, not only to kill us, but to just brutalize us, and just like the scripture said, to devour us, to slurp up our juices, just to pull off an arm, pull off a leg, and eat it, and separate the juices. Now, I knew they wanted to do that to me and my little friend. But praise the living God, there was another man that was standing over us, and I knew this man was protecting us. And the man said, "Fear not, for I'm here to protect you." And I didn't fear the man. Now, dear, that was the Lord. That man, other man, was an angel of the Lord. I didn't know at the time. I don't know, I did not fear that man. I knew that those things out there called the demons, things. I know anything about demons. And they tried to come through the door. I could see the door trying to be open. And the angel said, "They can't come through here because I got it blocked." And that finally, I believed that man, and I went on to sleep. Next morning, I got out of there and never stayed with my uncle again. You see, that's what the devil wants to do, is to devour us. So thank God for mature, spiritually men and women of God who are spiritually mature, gone through some things like Peter, to want us to be sober, to be vigilant, to let us know that we always have an adversary, an enemy who's the devil. And just like that one line, always looking to see who, what animal it could kill and eat and slurp up. The devil walketh about, thinking whom that he may devour, whom he may slurp up, whom he may drink. Mm-hmm. Be sober. Now, any pastor could testify that he or she has seen lives that were consumed by the work of the devil. Very often, those things happen because a believer left a door open. And through that open door, the devil got into their life. And this is so serious, and the potential for destruction is so real, that Peter began this verse by saying, "Be sober." So do I know to prevent that from happening, we need to be sober. In the context of a satanic attack, what does that mean? The word sober, again, is from the Greek word, and I try to pronounce it, nepo, N-E-P-H-O, which means many things. And some of the things that it means in the Greek is to be sober or not drunk. We all know that. To be free from alcoholic intoxication. We all know that. To be free from delirium, delusions, hallucinations that may accompany drunkenness. And then this ain't just talking about a physical drunkenness. This is also a spiritual drunkenness. As a matter of fact, that's what it's talking about, a spiritual drunkenness. Be sober. Spiritually, be sober. We know we should be sober physically, and many of God's children are sober physically, but spiritually, they are drunk, in a drunken state. They're intoxicated. They're not sober. I was in an intoxicated state for 10 years and didn't even know it. Now, in the natural, you would say God has blessed me. But spiritually speaking, no. I was spiritually intoxicated, spiritually drunk. Also, the Greek meaning for the word sober means to think straight and not like a silly drunk. So a drunken person physically don't think straight. Well, spiritually, when a person is spiritually drunk, they don't think straight. Because the word of God is not in them to even think straight. Your mouth speak what's in the heart. So the word of God is not in their heart. So how can they think straight? How can they speak straight? That's why Job told his wife, "You talk like a foolish person." She was drunken. Spiritually speaking, she was drunk. It means to be free of silly thinking and hence able to have presence of mind and clear judgment. Only the word of God will enable us to have a clear mind, which will produce clear judgment. It means being in control rather than being controlled by urges, impulses, whim, and frustration, frustrating emotion. When you're sober, you're not controlled by your emotion. You know, I got a call last night from a young woman. Her emotion was frustrated, talking foolish, and she was being attacked, and the enemy was about to win. But praise God, she called me, and I could lead her in thinking straight. So this morning, when I called, she was okay, all is well. And the Holy Spirit told her what to do. There were some idols in her house. Holy Spirit said, get rid of it. She tried to think what was wrong with it, and she couldn't. So she said, you know what, Lord? You said to get rid of it, so it means something is wrong with it. I'm getting rid of it. And she said, the moment she said that from her heart, it's like that spirit left her. Mm-hmm. Also, another meaning, Greek meaning for the word sober means to have one's wits about themselves, to be rational as opposed to irrational. It means to be free from a drunken state in which one drops their guard. It is more like to give way to foolish behavior, unreasonable conversation, and detrimental decisions. You know, watch your conversations with people. This young lady, I even remind her of conversation that she had with a relative. You need to cut off those conversations. They don't build you up in Christ Jesus. Change the subject to the Lord, and they'll stop talking to you. Be careful, Joy. Don't matter if it's family member. When you're sober, you're free from unreasonable conversation and detrimental decisions. So, dear, simply, the word sober in this verse, but Peter telling us to be sober because we have an adversary, it simply means to be serious-minded. So again, don't become offended when someone tells you, so why you got to be so serious? Now you got to answer for them because I'm sober. You're like, huh? Uh-huh, I'm sober. Spiritually, I'm sober. I'm not drunk. So to be sober is to be serious-minded. Serious of mind about your life in Christ Jesus, about your walk in Christ Jesus. Dear Lord, we got to learn how to cut off relatives. We love our relatives, our brothers, our sisters, our parents, our spouse, our children. But you cannot let them come to you in their drunken state, talking foolishly and going along with it, unreasonable conversation. You know what's going to happen? The enemy, the adversary, is going to devour you. Otherwise, you're going to get all confused, wondering what's wrong with you. You have to cut that conversation. You don't have so much cut them off. You need to say, look, I don't want to hear that. What would Jesus do? You know, let's think about this. What would Jesus say? Jesus, what would you say? Holy Ghost, what would Jesus say? And Holy Spirit, take you to God's word. And that person who listens to you, they'll say that you are drunk. You say, yeah, I'm drunk in the Holy Ghost. Because when you're drunk in the Holy Ghost, you'll talk Holy Ghost talk. Praise the living God. Now, there are six key verses in the New Testament where this word, nepo, N-E-P-H-O, is used. So that's, remember, that's the Greek word for the word sober. In 1 Thessalonians, the 5th chapter, verse 6, the Apostle Paul uses to describe responsible living in the light of God's coming. He said, therefore, let us not sleep, you see, as do others. So there are going to be some Christians who are just spiritually asleep, spiritually drunk. The scripture just said, therefore, let us not sleep as do others. Some people sleep. But let us watch and be sober. Considering what sober means in the Greek, we could translate this verse like this. Let us watch and think clearly, not like silly drunks who drop their guard and make foolish mistakes. And there are many Christians who have dropped their guard and is making foolish mistakes. As my Lord said, by their fruit, you should know them. Now, Paul used this word again two verses later, 1 Thessalonians 5th chapter, verse 8, when he said, but let us who are of the day, I mean, those who are sober, let us, in other words, be sober. We are of the day. We are in the light, walking in the light of Christ Jesus. Let us be sober. Now, this could actually be translated like this. But let us who are of the day be clear and rational in our thinking. Now, in 2 Timothy 4, chapter verse 5, we find the third use of this word as Paul urged Timothy to be very level-headed. He said, but watch thou in all things, enduring affliction, do the work of an evangelist. Remember, evangelist proclaim the good news of Jesus Christ and make full proof of thy ministry. I mean, make full proof of your calling, you know, of your salvation. Be serious about it. And that is our ministry, dear heart. That phrase, watch thou, is from the Greek word nepo. Remember, that's sober. Be sober. And that verse could be better translated like this. Keep your head on straight, get a grip on yourself, and think straight, not like a silly drunk. That's why some of you send me email messages, and your email message is like a silly drunk. It's like a drunken person sending me email. I don't read them. So don't get upset at me if I don't respond. When you send me an email with your head on straight, you got a grip on yourself, you're thinking straight, then I answer your email. But if not, I am not answering the email. Matter of fact, I don't read it. Holy Ghost said, don't read it. Because if I read it, it'll put me in a drunken state. Now, although this verse was originally written to Timothy, you know, it was originally written to Timothy, but you know, it ain't just for Timothy. Is for all of us following in the footsteps of Timothy, pursuing the Lord. So even though the original verse was written to Timothy, Paul was prophesying that there would be a lot of nonsensical thinking in the last days. And that is so true. And we are actually seeing that today. There are many people are irrational and no longer thinking straight. I mean, thinking in the Word of God. Well, the only way you think straight is when you allow the Holy Ghost to renew your mind in His Word. That's how we think straight. People, they are intoxicated by the spirit of the world, and their thinking is off course. This person, again, who notified me yesterday, have a sister. All she do is watch movies. When she talked to her, she talking to her about movies. See, her thinking is off course. And when she sat there and just listened, she started talking about movies too. Then her thinking became off course. Until it got off course, and then she felt the impact when she went off course. Again, praise the living God. The Holy Ghost said, call the woman of God so that she can get back on track and think straight. Beware, dear heart. Remember a person, enemy, or foe, according to the Word of God. It's not in somebody who's not related to you. It's those in your own household. Be warned. So for us, this verse means, don't be affected by the spirit of the age. Don't be intoxicated with the same thing that's intoxicating the rest of the world. Be free of the spirit of the age, which is the wrong thinking and the wrong and the deception that is in the world. That's the spirit of this age. And it is wrong thinking and deception that is in the world. Don't be affected by it. Now, another use of nepo, N-E-P-H-O, which is the Greek meaning, the Greek word for sober, is in 1 Peter, 1st chapter, verse 13, which begins, "Wherefore, gird up the loins of your mind, be sober." Now, this verse portrays a marvelous picture of sober thinking. In Roman times, when a runner ran, he would gird up the loins by grabbing the loose, dangling ends of his skirt and tucking them under his lawn belt. Why? Because if he allowed his skirt to dangle while he was running, it could get caught in his legs and it would hinder his race. So a good runner would tuck those loose ends under his lawn belt so his legs could move freely. Now, this verse is saying to us, grab all the dangling ends of your life, all your loose places, your distractions, and everything that will hinder your race, and get them out of the way so you can run freely and attain your goal. Then 1 Peter, the first chapter, verse 13, continues, be sober. The word sober could be translated this way. Wherefore, gird up the loins of your mind and put away irresponsible and foolish thinking that leads to bad decisions. Think straight, not like a silly drunk. Really, this verse is calling us to responsible living, responsible Christian living. Why? Because the Lord, he's coming again. We have a race to run before he returns. And to run this race, we must be sober. We have to think clearly. The only way, again, we think clearly is when we're in the Word of God. Say what Jesus says. 1 Peter 4, chapter, verse 7 is also a call to responsible living in light of Christ's soon return. It says, but the end of all things is at hand. Be ye therefore sober and watch unto prayer. Watch yourself. Not watching others, but watch yourself unto prayer. The word sober again is again the Greek word nepo, N-E-P-H-O. And the first part of this verse could be translated like this. Be free from the intoxication of life. Be free from the intoxication of life. Why? Because when a person becomes intoxicated, he or she drops their guard. It becomes a time of foolishness. And they will make bad decisions and bad things take place. This echoes our main verse in 1 Peter 5, chapter, verse 8. It says, be sober, be vigilant, because your adversary, the devil, as a roaring lion, walks about thinking whom he may devour. Throughout the New Testament, especially in Paul's and Peter's writing, the word sober is primarily used as a warning to get a grip on ourselves and for us to think straight and not like a silly drunk. And we only can get a grip on ourselves through the Word of God. Remember that our adversary, the devil, the roaring lion, walketh about, looketh in who he may devour, not only to destroy, but to drink their juices. Yo, let us continue to be sober. Stay in the Word of God. The Word of God keeps us sober. We cannot make it without God's Word. Now, those who say, well, I just don't have time for God's Word. Well, you ain't thinking straight. And that's why the devil is devouring you. If I feel like you're just losing your mind. You had a young lady yesterday, like she was about to lose her mind. Mind was that it's been, the demon had the mind just pulling her mind. Why? Because of listening to wrong conversations, not remaining sober, remaining God's word. So she'd be able to get a grip on herself and to think straight. Let her example be a wonder for you and I, dear heart, that we too remain sober. And the word of God keeps us sober. The word of God, dear heart, keeps us safe. So it keeps us and help us and continue to think straight, to get a grip on ourselves. Praise the living God. Now, 2 Timothy, the 2nd chapter, verse 15, say, still should show thyself approved to God, a workman that need not be ashamed. See, we all are workers in this harvest for the Lord Jesus Christ. And we need to study to show ourselves approved to God so that we won't be ashamed whenever someone asks us a question. We quickly give them an answer because we rightly can divide the word of truth. 2 Timothy 2 chapter verse 15. Now the Greek, there's another Greek word, katapino, K-A-T-A-P-I-N-O. Now it's translated devour in 1 Peter 5 chapter verse 8. Has its root in the meaning to drink. Now, how does this truth help you see that verse differently? So when you read 1 Peter 5th chapter, verse 8, remember the word devour means not just to destroy, but to drink. So knowing this truth now, how does it help you see that verse differently now? Because you only equate it to the word divide to destroy. It actually means to drink. Again, picture that lion who just killed its prey and eating the flesh to the bone and drinking the juices. That's what Satan wants to do to you and me. Also, comparing the 6 key verses in the New Testament where the Greek word nepo is used. 1 Thessalonians 5th chapter, verses 6 and 8. 2 Timothy, the 4th chapter, verse 5. 1 Peter, 1st chapter, verse 13. 4th chapter, verse 7. 5th chapter, verse 8. How you describe the spiritual mindset every believer should have? What does the application of this mindset look like in everyday life? What is one example of an opposing mindset? Also, 1 Peter, the 1st chapter, verse 3, could be translated. Grab all the dangling ends of your life, all your loose places, your distractions, and everything that will hinder your race. And get them out of the way so you can run freely and attain your goal. Now, knowing this truth and the new revelation meaning of 1 Peter 1 and 1st chapter verse 3. Now, what are the 3 examples of dangling ends in your own life? What are the 3 examples of dangling ends of your own, in your own life? Look over your own life and find those dangling ends. Praise the living God. James 1st chapter verse 22 tells us the order. This practical application for us to be doers of the word, not just hear the word only. When we hear the word and not do it, you not know we're deceiving our own self, and that devourer is laughing at you. And those of you who say, well, I come to Holy Ghost Fire Talk and I listen, but you know what? I'm still being attacked as though the enemy's on the inside of me. Well, maybe that's because you're just a hearer of the word and you're not a doer of the word. You know, seek to hear the word and you seek to do the word. Because when you just seek to hear the word and not do it, you deceive yourself. You know, I used to be like that too. I would go to church, I would hear the word and have, oh yeah, uh-huh. And I could quote the word to you, but I was not a doer of the word. And the devil just laughed at me. And he was ripping me apart. Praise the living God. God, mercy and grace. That's all. His mercy and grace saved me. And I turned around. You know, that'd be a straddle defense. I never forget, I had this dream, young girl, had this dream. Dear Lord, I was on top, standing on top of the fence, running up the fence, just on the fence, running up the fence. And I woke up and I said, what in the world? And Lord said, you straddled the fence on top of it. I was not on the left side on the ground. I was not on the right side on the ground. I was just on top of the fence, running. And when I thought about the Lord, I knew he was right. Because I knew the word of God. There were certain things that I obeyed the Lord in. There were other things I just didn't want to because I wasn't ready yet. So I thought I could have both. Well, so you can't have both. You have to choose. So you just can't hear the word of God and not do it. You straddle the fence. You deceive your own self. And that's James again, chapter 1, verse 22. Now, when I ask what examples of the dangling ends in your life, when you think of the dangling ends of your life, choose one of the three dangling ends, and then you develop a concrete plan to tuck that in. So whatever the dangling ends in your life, choose three of them. And then after you choose those three, then get the rest of them. You know, do it little bit by little bit. You might can't tuck all those ends in at the same time, but you can do a little bit by little bit. You develop a concrete plan. And that plan is to apply yourself to the word of God. And that's how you tuck that thing in. Then implement that plan and eliminate that habit. And some of you still smoking cigarettes. That's a dangling end. So what's the plan? The plan is don't go to the store, buy those cigarettes. Destroy what you got. Don't go tuck that thing in. Tuck that end in. And don't go buy no more cigarettes. That's how you eliminate that habit. So again, implement that plan and eliminate that habit, whatever the circumstance is, even the circumstance. Sometimes we put our own selves in circumstances and we can tuck that thing in. Say, no, I'm not going to do that. Or thought that keeps you from freely running your Christian race. Even the thoughts that come into your head. You know, Vantage King, you don't have to do what she say. And you're right, you don't do what I say. Do what the Holy Ghost says. And you need to tell yourself that and tell the devil that. Take that thing in and say, you're right. I don't have to do what Vanity King says. I do what the Holy Ghost says. Now, whether it be a financial, relational, emotional, other kind of situation, think of an area where you do not have your own head on straight. Once you identify that area, ask the Holy Spirit to give you one verse that will help you think soberly. One verse that will help you think soberly about that issue. And then you meditate on that verse until it becomes a part of you. It don't matter how long it takes. See, our question, our problem is, I don't know, I guess we want microwave revelation. Microwave. Action, macro, we want everything now. Some things just take time. So whatever that problem is, the Holy Ghost, give me a verse on it. And you get that verse and you meditate on it. Keep on meditating. Don't just think about it one or two times and forget about it. No, continue to meditate on it, no matter how long it takes.
Continue to meditate on it until it becomes a part of you, until it becomes deep down on the inside of you. You know, a few years ago, I had a stroke, and I didn't know it was a stroke. My husband said, I woke up to him saying, telling me get off the floor on the bed. Well, I thought I was already on the bed. And then my version of what happened, I thought I was halfway on the bed. I couldn't make, but then I saw Roger leaning on that. We got a window unit, air conditioner in our room. I saw Roger leaning on the window unit of the air conditioner, looking at me, waiting to see what was going to happen. Here I am looking at him, wondering why he ain't over here helping me get on this bed. Why he looking at me like he waiting on something? Why he's not helping me? And that's my version of it. Finally, my version of it, I found myself back on the bed. And then when I finally came through the heart, I could not talk. My right side, my hand, like it was crippled, couldn't hold it up. It was like it was not paralyzed, but deformed, like twisted or something. I couldn't lift it up. And I could not think. I could then I have one thought. I tried to think some thoughts and I couldn't. Definitely I could not talk. So I heard Roger saying that Robert going to work. So you okay? And I said, I mumbled, See, I'm hearing his pressure. He thought I was okay. I said, But he didn't know the condition I was in. So he left to go to work. I said, oh, God. I said, there's a lot of things that you said I would be doing here. And it has not come to pass yet. You will have to help me, Jesus. So I got up. The only thing that would come to my mind was the verse. I could do my favorite verse. And then I did not know it was my favorite verse until then, because that was the verse that was deep down on the inside of me, that was a part of me. Because I spoke that all the time. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. That was the only thing that I could remember saying. And that was the right thing that was needed. So from 8 a.m. to 5 p.m., I quoted that verse. Do you not know by the time 5 p.m. came, I could talk, I could think again, I could raise my hands again. The signs of that stroke were completely gone. Now, remember, I still didn't know it was a stroke at the time. It was actually here so late I found out it was a stroke. But ain't God good, dear heart? So again, when you identify the area in your life where you don't have your head on straight, you're not sober, ask the Holy Spirit to give you one verse that will help you think soberly about the issue. Then meditate on that verse until it becomes a part of you. And that's what I did when I kept quoting, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. At first, all I could do was think it. Then I said, okay, let me try to say it. And I would say, blah, 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 blah. I would mumble. Blah, 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 blah. But I kept on. And I kept on. Finally, I got out of word. I can't. Finally. Then finally, I got out the whole verse by 5 p.m. You know, last time I was in the hospital, and they asked me if I ever had a stroke. I said, yeah, I had a stroke. And they say, when? No. They asked me, am I allergic to something? I said, yeah, ibuprofen. They said, why? I said, because it caused me to have a stroke. They said, what? I said, yeah. And I told them. And I give the same story how God healed. And they get just as quiet. Lord, I thank God for the Holy Ghost. Thank you, Jesus, for the work of Calvary Hill and accomplishing your mission, your vision, your task for the Father. And indeed, he sent his word back to us, the Holy Ghost, to be not only with us, but to be in us. He keeps us as we're willing to be kept. See, Jehovah, we got to be willing to be kept by the Holy Ghost. He keeps us. Thank you for protecting us. It's just your mercy and your grace. There's nothing that we could ever do. It's what Jesus Christ has done. It's your mercy and your grace. Thank you, Lord, for your mercy endures forever. We have nothing to complain about, but everything to be thankful about. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. I was going to add also, what does it mean to be vigilant? But I think I'm going to keep that separate. Because in this teaching how to keep the devil out of your life, there's 10 lessons. And I want to do each one separately instead of combining them. So lesson two would be, what does it mean to be vigilant? So make sure you tune into the live broadcast now on Monday and Friday at 12 noon Eastern Standard Time. Praise the living God. Dear, I thank God for this teaching, because I learned. I was really shocked to see the word devour meaning also to drink. I'm telling you, like I said, I watch National Geographic all the time, and I seen those lions eat their prey, and ooh, they be slurping up the juices and stuff, and that's how the devil wants to do us. I mean, the prey be alive, and they eating on them. That's what the devil wants to do us. And do you not know, the Lord just said to me, that's what the devil and his demons are doing to people who are in hell right now. And they're feeling that pain over and over. It's happening over and over again. They never have any rest. The devil fool people and say it's best to commit suicide. You go to a better place. No, dear, you're going to a worse place. Because that's exactly what demons are doing to the human beings who are there now. Killing them. They pulling off arms and pieces of their flesh. They eating it. And they are feeling it. Lord, they are feeling it. They still have their feelings. And then they are sucking up the juices. They're feeling it. And then when they finish it, it happens all over again. Ain't that terrible? So God is wanting you and I. Why we have a chance. He's wanting us that we should stay sober. Stay sober, dear Lord, in Jesus' name. Okay. So those who are attending the live broadcast, now the evangelists attending the live broadcast, I give you an opportunity to ask a question only pertaining to the message that was taught. Okay. So I'm going to unmute the live listeners. And if you have a question, you just present the question. If you don't have a question, say, Benj King, I don't have a question. Praise God. Okay? Praise the living God. All right, I'm going to unmute 1283 to see if you have a question. 1283, you have a question pertaining to the message? Feel free.
God bless you.
Amen.
Yes, God. Amen. God bless you. I was calling for prayer, but I do want to say I really enjoyed the message. It was a blessing, and it was exactly a lot of the things that you were speaking of is what I've been going through. So I was really blessed by the message and the word of God today. And
amen.
The
amen.
Amen. Yeah.
Now, you said you were calling for prayer. You're talking about deliverance prayer? Or just a general prayer?
As the Holy Spirit leads. I've been going through a lot of things where my life has been fought greatly demonically, like people fighting me.
It sounds like you need deliverance. You need deliverance prayer. You need deliverance prayer. See, there are different types of prayers. In your case, you were looking for a general prayer, but you actually need a deliverance prayer. Now, on Mondays and Fridays, it's Holy Ghost Fire Talk. It's where I do teachings of the Word of God. Tuesday mornings at 8 a.m. is Shalom Morning Prayer, where I do a teaching of the Word, and we have corporate prayer. But on Sundays at 2 p.m. Eastern Standard Time, it's best to go to the website, thechildrensmite.org/deliverance, mm-hmm. and you can also request a video deliverance session, which I have on sometimes. When I do have it during the week, it'll be on Thursday. So go to the website, thechildrensmite.org/deliverance, okay, so you can receive your deliverance prayer. Now, make sure you do it now, because the demons, they are so sneaky, and they're going to do everything in their power. So you got connected to the woman of God, the woman of God who God has anointed, appointed for such a time as this, and they know that. So now they're going to do everything in their power to convince you not to show up, not to call him, okay? Because they know if you do, they got to leave the house. They got to go, got to vacate the premises. So they're going to try everything in their being to persuade you, convince you not to show up, okay? So, but make sure you obey the voice of the Holy Ghost, okay? And get delivered. Just go to the website, thechildrensmite.org/deliverance. And you see those instructions, okay?
Okay. Yes, ma'am.
All right. And continue to tune in after your deliverance. Also continue to tune in, because messages like this and teaching the Word of God, it helps you to maintain your deliverance. Now, this is what you call self-deliverance. Self-deliverance is a post-deliverance. These are things that you do to maintain your deliverance. It's not a pre-deliverance, you see. It's things that you do after you've truly been delivered, so you continue to be delivered, to keep those thieves out of the house from being on the inside of you. They're always supposed to be on the outside. So you make sure you obey the Holy Ghost and you come and get your deliverance, all right?
Amen, I sure will.
Amen, amen. Praise the living God. All right, I'm going to mute you now. So I'm going to unmute 4491. Just let me know if you have a question pertaining to the message or not. 4491, you have a question?
No question.
Okay. All right. Also, 9807, do you have a question?
Yes. Yes, it's Gary from Texas. Yes. Okay, well,
What's your question?
Well, yes, my question is that, yes, I am very blessed of the message that you talked about.
Mm-hmm.
But the thing is that I have been going through a lot lately. I mean, yes, I have been getting to the Word of God and doing the very best I can, but it looks like I am having trouble trying to be a doer of the Word. And so
you
haven't
been a doer.
Now, you said you haven't been
a doer of the Word. What specific word are you having trouble doing?
Well, it's more like, you know, leading people to Christ Jesus, like in person.
Okay, repeat that again. You have a problem specifically. You have a problem doing what?
Okay, well, it's more like I have a problem of leading people to Christ Jesus, probably because, you know, I'm gonna, you know.
Okay. All right.
Yeah.
It's not your time yet to lead people to Christ Jesus. You first got to work out your own soul salvation. You first got to get yourself right. So you need to stop trying to lead people to Christ Jesus. You lead people to Christ Jesus through your actions and your reaction. You need to reflect on your own actions and your reaction. Get yourself right. Meditate on God's word. Pursue his word. And you keep doing it. Look at Jesus. He did it 30 years before the Father sent him out. So if it takes you 10 years, 20 years, you keep doing it. You keep doing it.
Yeah.
Don't have your mindset that you want to be leading people to Christ. You know, when you get your actions, reaction reflected as the Holy Spirit will, whether you realize it or not, someone is watching you, they're seeing you, and through your action, your reaction, you are leading them. Okay?
Yeah. Right.
That's all you just need to do. All right.
And also, like,
all right.
And also, like, yeah.
Okay. That's it. All right, that's it. I just give you one question, because you can go on and on. No, I know who this is. Praise the living God. Amen. Yeah, you have to be a disciple first before you can disciple others. Okay? So we get your action, your reaction in relation to the Word of God. Keep pursuing Him. Keep tuning in and not only listening to the Word of God, but also be a doer of God's Word. Now, you continue doing that, you are being discipled, and then at God's appointed time, then you'll be able to disciple others. It's just not the time now. That's it. No more questions, because I know you. People are like, why are you doing this person? Because I know this person. You know, it's like having your own children. You know, your children, you know your children. But other parents don't know your children. So when you do a certain thing to your child, they say, why are you doing that child like that? Because that's my child. I know my child. You don't know this child. So I know this person. In the spirit, I know this person. You don't know this person. So that, like the Lord told Peter, when the Lord told Peter how he was going to glorify him in his death, and then Peter, the scripture said Peter looked up and he saw John coming. So there, Peter wanted to flip the script. Well, what about him? Lord said, in other words, the Lord said, what about him? If I want him to live until I come, and that is none of your business, you see. So some things you hear transpire between a man or woman of God to a disciple, you don't understand. And the Holy Spirit not give you that understanding, the best thing you should do is just say, okay, Lord, that is not my business because you have not revealed it to me. And I learned from there, from that example of Peter regarding John, just some things are just not my business. God, don't tell me. I don't interfere with it. So just be careful, okay? Because, again, I know this person. So, again, you be a disciple first. You learning, you following Jesus Christ, you learning of Him. Hear His word, be obedient to His word. Work out your own soul's salvation. You know, ask Him to deal in your actions, in your reaction. Make your action reaction to reflect Him. Because He needs to work on the inside of you. There's some things that got to be uprooted out of you, because that stubbornness is still in there. That stubbornness is deep down in you, and that thing got to be uprooted. Only thing going to uproot it is the word of the living God, the word of God. So you have to, when the word of God's uprooting it, you have to ask the Holy Spirit, humble me to accept your word, your plan that you're doing in my life to make me just like Christ on the inside. Humble me. And as you humble, submit, and humble yourself, as the Holy Spirit continues to root out things out of you, it won't be as difficult. You say, praise your holy name, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you. See, I can tell you this because that's how He does me. Praise the living God. So don't worry about trying to lead other Christ Jesus by your own works, but seek that Christ change you on the inside to reflect you just like Him. Okay? Praise God.
Yeah.
All right. All right, everybody. Thank you for tuning into this live broadcast. Again, come back on as a matter of fact, tomorrow, Tuesday morning at 8 a.m. Eastern Standard Time for Shalom Morning Prayer. I do a light teaching, and then we have corporate prayer. And then again on Friday, we'll start with lesson 2, my Holy Ghost Fire Talk at 12 noon Eastern Standard Time. Okay? All right, now, you all stay blessed. In Jesus' mighty name. Shalom.